A defiant PDP Laban Vice Chairman Alfonso Cusi insisting he was not expelled from the ruling party. Former Comelec Commissioner Gregorio Larrazabal bashed for joining the consultative tour of possible 2022 tandem. Senator Panfilo Lacson and Senate President Vicente Soto III will get attorney Larrazabal's side of the story today. The Philippines marks the fifth anniversary of the landmark ruling negating China's sweeping claims in the West Philippine Sea. We'll discuss that with former Supreme Court Associate Justice Francis Hardilesa later on in the program. And in sports, the Milwaukee Bucks dominate the Phoenix Suns in Game 3 of the NBA Finals. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. And thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. We begin with this growing rift within the ruling PDP-Laban party. See, the vice chairman and deputy secretary general of PDP-Laban, he's not recognizing their supposed expulsion from the party. Alfonso Cusi, PDP-Laban vice chair and energy secretary, insists they were not kicked out. He claims party president Senator Manny Pacquiao had no authority to expel any member, nor did the committee that ordered their removal. Cusi calling Pacquiao's actions a cheap political gimmick. Cusi, along with Deputy Secretary General Melvin Matibag, were removed last week for supposedly violating several provisions of PDP-Laban's constitution. Matibag says the move is against the party's bylaws.
Yung ginawa pong nilang aksyon na yan, na pagpapatalsik daw sa amin, ay labag po sa bylaws ng atin pong partido. Kasi naman po, wala naman pong disciplining authority ang National Executive Council. Lalong higit, yung pong committee na yan ay committee lamang na create po ng ni Senator Manny Pacquiao. Maliwanag po sa bylaws ng PDP Article 7, sinasabi ron yung pong pagdisiplina sa mga miyembro. Ang pwede lang pong gumawa niyan ay ang chapter kung saan sila napabibilang o kung saan National Council po sila napapaloob.
Developments like this will further deepen the factions within the party. So, yun ang nakakapag-worry na sana, kasi pag nag-expel na, parang nawawala na yung opportunity for dialogue. So sana magkausap nga talaga na, or magkaroon man lang ng consultation with the members, and then whatever happens there, everybody respects because that's the membership that has decided.
Party Chairman President Rodrigo Duterte has been on the offensive against Pacquiao for criticizing the administration. The senator has also been engaged in a word war against Cusi after a party meeting in May resulted in a resolution urging Duterte to seek the vice presidency in next year's national election. Quirino Governor Dakila Cua explains why he supported that resolution.
I think important kasi ngayon, if there's ang importante ngayon na may pandemya, no? I'm thinking about the Filipino people. Ang pananaw ko kasi, the people are not so into politics now. They're thinking about hanap buhay. Ang daming ibang mas mahalagang tanong. I think the president can help reduce those pangangamba about the future, those uncertainties, because he remains to be a figure that a lot of Filipinos support.
Former Commission on Elections Commissioner Gregorio Larrazabal allegedly bashed for joining this so-called tour of Luzon of Senator Panfilo Lacson and Senate President Vicente Soto III, who are reportedly planning to run as a tandem in next year's polls. In a tweet, Senator Lacson claims the criticisms came from Larrazabal's yellow followers. For more on this, we're now joined by Attorney Larrazabal. Attorney Goyo, welcome to the program.
No, good morning.
Good afternoon na nga.
Before we start, just a reminder to everybody, voter registration is ongoing Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Deadline for registration, voter registration is September 30. Don't wait the last minute. You can register as voters already now.
All right. Glad that you issued that reminder because, you know, on Twitter, people were also reminding you of basically they're saying You're going after all these reforms, and yet with one single tweet and one show of support, you basically negated all those moves for electoral reforms, supporting what they call our enablers. First of all, how are you taking the backlash? Go ahead.
Okay, some people can say, I tweeted that Saturday morning, and I was driving. I was driving from La Union. So I wasn't able to reply. I got into Guiguerao evening already. So the whole day I was on the road, I wasn't able to check my Twitter feed that often. So people wondering, why are you so quiet? Why are you so quiet? I said, sorry, I was driving. I was busy in the real world. I was busy in the real world connecting with people. So parang you mentioned that in some one single tweet, I negated everything. Says who? I mean, says some people who have this predisposed concept of what they think is right and wrong. It's kind of wrong. That in itself is, there's something wrong in that statement, because we live in democracy. In fact, that's what I've been promoting. You can vote whoever you want as long as you choose, as long as you vet the people you're going to vet to going to vote for. But importantly, you register as voters and vote.
Attorney Goyo, do you understand where the criticisms are coming from?
Yes, I do.
And where do you think they're coming from?
Some people think that I should go one way, but just because I'm not going the same direction they want or they're going, and I'm wrong, di ba? So, but that's their opinion. I respect that. In fact, some people message me, "Are you okay?" Or you say, "Sabi ko, okay lang. If I get bashed, so what? That's their opinion. I can't change it. I can't argue it, because never that code non habit. You cannot. One's opinion is never subject to argument. That's their opinion. Let them have that opinion. We live in the democracy. If I shove my opinion down their throat, that's wrong. If they shove their opinion about a particular issue down my throat and force me to think their way, and that's also wrong. So, kanya-kanya, and that's what we've been. That's what I've been advocating. We should learn to agree to disagree. We might have different opinions about a particular issue, but at the end of the day, we're all Filipinos. We all should look for a better tomorrow for our loved ones.
And obviously, that better tomorrow for you, or I don't know, have you made up your mind? Is that better tomorrow going to be courtesy of Senate President Vicente Soto III as VP and Senator Panfilo Lacson as President?
Well, I like their programs. And they even mentioned that if I decide to throw in my hat in the Senate race, I'll be in their ticket. But I'm seriously looking at it. But put it in context, I was asked to run for public office since 2013. I always said no. So those other political parties, they've been asking me to join already politics, but I said no. But now I'm looking at it again. I haven't made a final decision.
So which came first, though? Which came first? Their offer for you to run under their ticket if they so decide to make a go for it, or your support for their program and the agenda?
Okay, let me put it this way. Kasi Senate President Soto is the president, is the chairman of NPC, Nationalist People's Coalition. I am the counsel of NPC. I help Nationalist People's Coalition. And Senator Lacson, as I've been conversing with him about driving, because I drive around the Philippines. As part of my advocacy in encouraging people to register as voters, that's, I drive around the Philippines in a safe and healthy manner. I try as much as possible. So they said that, you know, next time I drive, would it be possible that they'll join me, because they also want to reach out to their constituencies and ask what are the possible problems and their views of particular issues. And I said, okay, sure, why not? You know, Carmina, if you ask me, hey, Goyo, can I join you in the ride? I say, sure, why not? As long as we have good intentions for our fellow Filipinos.
All right. So when was it that you, first of all, is it clear to you already that they're the ones you're going to support?
Well, at this point in time, no, I'm with them. I believe in their programs. I will wait for their announcement. They said that they're going to make an announcement August 5. So I'll wait for their announcement, and I don't want to preempt what they're going to say.
And what is it?
Let me explain. Their programs are really good. In fact, I'm really impressed. I've sat in their meetings with some officials, businessmen, members of the clergy, and maganda yung explanation niya. And saka maganda yun na they were getting the feedback and opinion of the people they were talking with in the different provinces.
Hmm. What is it about their programs that that really is convincing you?
Okay, first and foremost, the sentiment of our fellow Filipinos in the countryside, Northern Luzon in this case, is that they feel they're not being heard. Their complaints are not being heard by the national government. I think sentiment is maririnig lang kami kasi kung magpo-post kami sa Twitter or Facebook, but kung we do regular channels, hindi kami pinapakinggan. That's something wrong, di ba? And going back to also their problems with the vaccines, kasi there's not enough vaccines. In fact, the distribution of the vaccines is problematic. That has been obvious in Iloilo, Tumaguete, some parts of Mindanao. There's an inequitable distribution of vaccines that should be addressed. Now, going to their programs. Senator Lacson had a program, Brave, wherein which there will be more devolution of funds and programs to the different LGUs. This would help the LGUs develop their municipalities, provinces, even barangays. What that would also do is that would decongest Metro Manila. That's actually a form of federalism right there, wherein which it empowers the LGU and it makes people want to go to the countryside and it will develop the countryside. So wala na yung people go to Manila because the jobs are here. No.
Yeah.
With these programs, the jobs will be in the countryside.
How do you then reconcile that with the not so recent past? The support for the anti-terror law, their silence on the drug war, their silence on the countless of killings. I guess that's why people were also so surprised how someone like Goyo could support such enablers.
Well, you know, enablers is a term being used by some people now. But with the anti-terror law, in fact, that's already in the Supreme Court now. There have been several cases filed against that law. And as a lawyer, I have views about it. I have apprehensions about the bill, the law. But we have, as lawyers, we have to wait for the Supreme Court to resolve. If the Supreme Court says, no, it's unconstitutional, then it's unconstitutional. But if the Supreme Court says that law is constitutional, then we have to follow the wisdom of the Supreme Court. With regards to other issues, for example, the drug issue. Yeah. Senator Soto has a very good program wherein which he learned from his experience as vice mayor of Quezon City. And he made a good point. No, we're focused on enforcement. We're not focused on the prevention. We're not focused on the limiting the demand. Because even if you cut off supply, if there still be a demand, people will still find ways to provide that supply. So my guess is that, and my opinion is that, you know, when you look at the drug problem, you have to have a holistic approach. Not everything is solved by enforcement. You kill the people wearing slippers, but you don't apprehend the people who supply the drugs. Then there's something wrong, because even if you kill the small time pushers and the consumers, if there will still be drugs that will come in, people will still go into drug addiction. So you have to look at it also from the point of view of educating the youth and forming the young early teens that, you know, drugs is bad. Emphasize to them that you should stay away from drugs.
How important is it for the tandem to hold this administration accountable?
I think it is very important. And if you look at my Twitter feed and my other social media platforms, that's my stand. You know, the administration has done some good things, but it's not perfect. There are some things that I wish didn't that do. And if you look at my Twitter feed again, you will see that I did point it out. But we have to make people accountable. If they did something good, commend them. If they did something bad, make them accountable.
But what do you know of the two senators' plan about holding the Duterte regime accountable?
That one, I'm sorry, I cannot speak about that aspect. But personally, there have been cases filed, and let's let the courts decide on that.
Mm. I want to bring in a picture here. It sure. shows you, of course, DJing, but what's important is what is printed yeah. on your shirt. It says, "In our house, we are all equal." But why is it that we find Attorney Goyo now sort of having to defend himself to these people who didn't like that one single tweet? Go ahead.
Not everything I do, people will like. Even in my family, there's some things me and my siblings don't like. Not everything, everyone will like 100% of what I do. Mm. That t-shirt is very important because that is a statement. In our house, we are all equal. That has two meanings. First is voting. Whether you're rich, whether you're a billionaire, whether you're married in debt, you have just one vote. That's your voice. Make it count. Second, that's the LGBT plus slogan, that in our house, we are all equal. So for before, I was advocating for the LGBT rights, plus rights, and I still do that. I still believe that they have a seat in the table, and no matter their preference, we're all Filipinos.
Mm. Okay, talking about that now, that has been your long-standing advocacy.
Yes.
I know
yeah.
that for a fact. But you're supporting two of the most macho men in the Senate, right? We okay. know what their stand is. We know yeah. what the stand of Senate President yeah. Vicente Soto III is regarding that.
Yeah.
How could you even think of aligning yourself with them?
You know,
even for that one issue.
Yeah, but you know, that macho thing, there's something wrong there, because I was with them. Really, if you sit down and talk with them, they're pretty sensible guys. Senate President Soto is actually very religious. We went to the churches in different parts, because that's when I designed the trip. His request is, isang request ko kung pwede pupunta tayo sa simbahan kada araw. I ask why, kasi that's what he wants to do. He wants to go to the church and pray. So, and he kids ka na, yung macho, it's actually macho no rin, because they always talk about their families and their yung concern ng family na and their wives, their bosses actually.
Mm.
So, it's
ang problema kasi if that finds its way into policy. Right.
Yeah, and that's why, for example, me, I'm here there are some concerns, there are some issues that we might not agree on, and I share my issues with them, because at the end of the day, they're in the Senate, and I have the opportunity to share a view that might not be same as theirs, but importante yan is we share what we think, and they take into consideration naman na, what I say, and hopefully it helps in the crafting of policy. Importante kasi we talk we might have different opinions about things, but importante we talk and we try to convince the others that our views should be taken into consideration.
So you said August 5 is the day when they're going to announce
that's
the final decision.
Yeah. That's what they said.
And the inclination, you spent quite a bit of time with them. Are they more inclined to go for it?
I think if they decide to throw in their hats in the political scene for 2022, based on what I've heard, no, I think it's going to be good for the Philippines, because we have to take a look at it from the point of view of how do we overcome the pandemic? How do we jumpstart the economy after this pandemic? I'm sure by next year, hindi pa, there's still going to be a pandemic, but how do we help the economy? We talked with some businessmen in Pampanga, and they're very worried, because many businesses have closed. The micro, small, medium enterprises, those small businesses which no one really minds, are struggling now, and we need to help them. We need to reach out and help them get back on their feet, because if they recover, and when they recover, they will help the communities, and we need to build we need to build the communities, we need to raise the communities up and make things better for the for our fellow Filipinos, especially in the countryside na naghirap talaga mga tao.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it at that. Attorney Goyo Larrazabal, good afternoon to you. Thanks too. Take care. Keep safe. Philippine health officials sounding the alarm over rising COVID-19 cases in Central Visayas. Dr. Eugenia Mercedes Canal of DOH Central Visayas says the upward trend in cases began during the last week of May. She attributes the rise to virus mutation, increased transmissibility, and the non-observance of minimum health protocols. But Canal clarifies the recent uptick in infections cannot be considered as a third wave. Recent government data shows Central Visayas has nearly 80,000 confirmed infections, 2,900 are considered active.
The most misconception na nakikita po natin or naririnig natin sa mga kababayan din natin, vaccinated ako, okay lang, napag-alagala na ako. That should not be the case po. Hindi naman natin mabiblame talaga po yan. Bakit sa po? LGUs or bakit sa mga po? Local chief executives natin kabayan. Kasi nga po, all the LGUs naman, all the LCEs have put their best foot forward naman po in terms of controlling the spread of the virus. Kaya nga lang po, itong mindset natin, it has to change. It has to become from the public, from the individual, and to the community as well, na dapat i-own up nila po yung responsibility.
The Philippines recorded 5,916 new COVID-19 cases on Sunday. This raises the country's tally to 1,473,000. Of that number, 49,701 are active infections. The health department also reported 105 additional fatalities, pushing the death toll to nearly 26,000. The Octo Research Group notes while fewer senior citizens are dying of COVID-19, there has been an increase in the number of minors falling victim to the virus. Metro Manila Mayor is set to release a list of outdoor places where children are allowed. That's after the country's COVID-19 task force allowed children as young as 5 years old outdoors in areas under general community quarantine and a modified GCQ. Under the new guidelines, children can now go to parks, outdoor tourist sites, outdoor non-contact sports courts, and al fresco dining with their parents or guardians.
Social distancing. Kung kaya yun ang titignan ng mga alkalde, ang gusto, yung pag-martial dito para wag maging super spreader event naman. Dahil baka masyadong masalik dumami. At wala naman sigurong magulang na ang gustong masamang mangyari sa kanyang anak. No? Kaya dapat talaga ayusin niya. Tingnan din nila on their own na kung madaming tao, wag na silang dumiretso.
We're going to take a break now. Up ahead, we'll turn our focus on the fifth anniversary of the landmark ruling invalidating China's sweeping claims over the West Philippine Sea. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC.
Worried kang magkasakit? Eh, kailangan magtrabaho. So, laban lang.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
We are back. Here's still with Dateline Philippines. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. A defiant PDP Laban Vice Chairman Alfonso Cusi insisting he was not expelled from the ruling party. Former COMELEC Commissioner Gregorio Larrazabal bashed for joining the consultative tour of possible 2022 tandem, Senator Panfilo Lacson and Senate President Vicente Soto III. The Philippines marks the fifth anniversary of the landmark ruling negating China's sweeping claims in the West Philippine Sea. And in sports, the Milwaukee Bucks dominate the Phoenix Suns in Game 3 of the NBA Finals. Back with more news, Philippine Vice President Lenny Robredo calls for the protection of Filipino fishermen as the country marks 5 years since the Hague ruling. Robredo says her office will send a team to Masinloc Town near the Scarborough Shoal to see how they can help fishermen who are still being harassed by the Chinese Coast Guard.
Ito talaga yung mukha nung problema doon, yung mga maliliit na mga mangingisda na sumusubok lang mabuhay. Tapos sila pa yung mahaharas, sila yung tatakutin, sila yung papaalisin. Ito yung sobrang nakakaawa. Pagpapaalala yung fifth anniversary, meron tayong pinaglalaban pa.
In a statement, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken called the Hague ruling an important victory for the rule of law in the South China Sea. Blinken reiterates the U.S. stands by its allies in defending maritime rights. Former Consul General Henry Bensurta Jr., the man behind Manila's policy on the maritime dispute versus Beijing, says a bilateral approach to China is simply not enough. He says this was why the Aquino administration decided to file a case against China before the International Court of Arbitration. He adds the standoffs between Philippine and Chinese vessels at the Scarborough Shoal in 2012 showed China's increasing aggression and lack of willingness to cooperate.
Limiting ourselves into a purely dialogue modality is playing into the hands of China's game because this is their strategy. I call it grab and stay. You grab a piece of feature or a piece of sea space, tension rise, they apply diplomacy to tell us, we're brothers, why don't we just resolve it among ourselves? It has the appearance of a good diplomatic solution. It has the appearance of a mission to be peaceful in terms of the approach, but underneath those appearances, you see unfairness, you see the trampling of our dignity.
Manila's arbitral win in the West Philippine Sea is a reminder of what good governance can yield. That declaration coming from the Liberal Party as the country marks the fifth anniversary of the Hague ruling. It was during the administration of the late President Benigno Aquino III that the Philippines brought China to the international court. The Liberal Party says the landmark ruling shows a leadership founded on the belief the Filipino is worth fighting for, as opposed to one that cowers and yields to bullies. Meanwhile, detained opposition leader Laila De Lima urges former Senior Associate Justice Antonio Carpio, former Solicitor General Florin Hilbay, and former Associate Justice Francis Hardelesa to stop the word war. Carpio earlier this month bared infighting among Aquino advisors on the West Philippine Sea, but De Lima says these are all irrelevant now and that they should all just take a bow for their role in the country's victory. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque denies reports Filipino fishermen are being harassed by the Chinese Coast Guard in the West Philippine Sea. Roque claims there are no reports these fishermen are unable to pursue their livelihoods because of Chinese incursions.
Whoever said it must not be reporting the truth and everything but the truth. I have personal knowledge na halos lahat po sila ay nakabalik na sa kanilang hanap buhay, lalong-lalo na dyan po sa Boro. No? So I dispute that.
More than 2 weeks ago, Manila's top diplomat Teodoro Loxin Jr. asserted the award on the South China Sea arbitration is final. He maintained the Philippines firmly rejects attempts to undermine the ruling. But while Loxin has filed several protests against China over its repeated incursions, President Duterte has kept friendly ties with Beijing, saying he does not want to antagonize the superpower. Duterte drew flak for calling the arbitral victory a mere piece of paper. Well, for more on the fifth anniversary of the Hague ruling, we're now joined by retired Supreme Court Associate Justice Francis Hardelesa. Justice Hardelesa, good afternoon to you, and thank you for joining us today. Welcome to the program.
Good afternoon.
Hi. All right. So the fifth anniversary of the ruling, now overshadowed by old wounds, opening up again in the fight for the arbitral award. Justice, why can't you just, according to Senator De Lima, take this as a win and just stop the bickering?
Well, I respect the view of Justice De Lima, of Secretary De Lima, but there is a place here for setting the record straight, because somebody is out to blacken the memory of somebody who just died. Mm.
And that somebody, of course, is Justice Antonio Carpio. Take us back to when the fighting happened.
I'll take you back. There was no fighting. Mm.
There was no bickering. But why is he saying that there was so? And you,
I don't know. I don't know why he's saying so. He was not part of the team, so he should explain where he gets his facts. Hmm.
And the effect of this to the legacy of the late President Noynoy Aquino and to the arbitral award itself. What do you think? How do you think these claims of Justice Carpio affect these two?
Well, that's why I am speaking out, and Florin Hilbay is speaking out very candidly. This blackened the memory of somebody who just died, who cannot anymore say what is the facts. Why all of these claims only now?
What do you think is fueling the justice here, the former justice here?
I do not know, but let me walk you through some of the claims.
Go ahead.
That's all.
Go ahead.
Okay. For example, the claim is that from the beginning there was bickering. The claim is that from the beginning,
there were differing approaches. That's one of the claims.
Yes, there were differing approaches.
Were there really? Were you not united?
That's completely untrue.
How can you say that that was completely untrue?
For example, there is a claim that Secretary Ochoa, after the team decided on instructions of the president to file the case, there is a claim that Secretary Ochoa changed the memorandum to the president. I only am familiar with one memorandum, and that's dated January 17. Now, if January 17, 2013, that's days before we filed the complaint with the UNCLOS. Now, I do not know where Justice Carpio got wind of this, and that's why I think the time has come for him. And obviously, he refers to Secretary Del Rosario as having made a different memo to come forward. And I will show them the January 17 memorandum of Secretary Ochoa to the president, which is unanimous. It cited the history of the claim.
Let me just ask you one question here, Justice Hardilesa. Were you surprised, or how surprised were you, when Justice Carpio began to make this his advocacy, make this his issue?
Well, I am surprised that while we were still mourning the death of President Aquino, he wrote his piece in a daily paper, which I characterize as speaking with a forked tongue. Because while he, in the beginning, he was praising President Aquino, and in the end, he injected lies in so many paragraphs.
No, but my question more was about the West Philippine Sea issue being his advocacy now. Were you surprised that he took this up, even if he wasn't there in the beginning?
Well, I do not know when his advocacy started. I cannot answer that. But what I can answer is I was appointed to be the Solicitor General, and I got instructions from President Aquino through Executive Secretary Ochoa to start the arbitration going. And he, and Mr. Carpio was not part at all of the arbitration.
And that is why I asked you that question, because he wasn't part of the arbitration. But then lately, he's been doing this. He's been fighting for this as his advocacy, sort of as his mission as well.
I have no quarrel with anybody having an advocacy. I have only a quarrel with somebody who doesn't tell the truth about what happened.
And what do you know? What can you tell us?
Tell you only about what I know. For example, Mr. Carpio claims that there was a meeting in Malacañang where he claims that Secretary Ochoa told the group, or told the president, that the Secretary Ochoa told Mr. Reichler, our counsel, that the decision of the group was not to include Ito Aba.
Correct. Okay.
Now, but that is only partly true. That the truth is, I was the one who called Mr. Reichler to Manila. Okay, because in the beginning, when we filed the case, nobody, none of the lawyers from DFA, none of the lawyers from OSG, not Mr. Reichler, not Mr. Carpio, none. I said, as in none, wala, mm-hmm. zero.
Mm-hmm.
That we should include Tito Abba.
Mm-hmm. Eh, pero ngayon, okay. pero, ngayon, but now, so, justice, yeah.
So, if you start with that, I have proof that at a meeting of the Philippine Law Journal, Mr. Carpio praised that filing of that complaint. He did not say anything about Aba. Nakalimutan niyo ang Ito Aba.
But now, there is this idea that maybe a joint development, a compromise development agreement with China on Ito Aba should be forged. What are your thoughts on that?
No, but see, that is where the story is important.
Mm.
You trace muna what happened, okay? So, when we filed the case, everybody was hunky-dory. Nobody said anything about Ito Aba. Now, when did Ito Aba get into the picture? Okay. I'm telling you, Mr. Carpio was not in the meetings of the lawyers, the Philippine lawyers, OSG, the Department of Foreign Affairs, the Department of the Department of Justice, when we decided this thing.
Mm.
So when did Ito Aba first figure? After we filed the case in January 2013, towards the middle of the year, or towards the, yes, the middle of the year, Mr. Reichler started to email me saying, essentially, we need to amend the statement of claim.
Mm-mm.
Okay? To amend it with respect to two things. Number one, to amend it with respect to Ayungin Shoal.
Mm-hmm.
I had no problems. We had no problems with Ayungin Shoal because the Ayungin Shoal was attempted to be barricaded or blockaded by China,
mm-hmm.
after we filed the complaint.
Yes.
Okay.
The second one? No,
the second one was Ito Aba. And when I was completely surprised, I said, what why mm-hmm. will you include now Ito Aba?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then he started to say many things, you know, Ito Aba this and Ito Aba that. And then it was about the same time, I think, that there is a German barrister or German lawyer who wrote a book about Ito Aba. Essentially, he was claiming that the complaint that we filed should be dismissed because we did not include Ito Aba.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And then that was when Reichler started to communicate with me. And then several weeks after, the book came out. And so I started to think that baka ito ang reason.
Mm-mm.
Okay?
Now, baka ano po ang reason?
This German lawyer by the name of Talmon, I met him.
Mm.
He denies, of course, that he was commissioned by China, but he wrote a book together with Chinese academics. They were debunking our claim.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the right context. So I met with the OSG. I said, ano ba ito? We met with Namria. Should we include Ito Aba or not?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'll tell you why up to that time we did not want to include Ito Aba.
Okay? Why is that?
Well, okay, the reason is Ito Aba is the largest feature in the South China Sea.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with Ito Aba was, did it have a natural source of potable water, meaning water that you can drink,
mm-hmm.
meaning water that can sustain life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, there was one or two law journals that claimed that there were wells there, but they were dated. We do not know whether this is true or not. But incidentally, Parminia, Ito Aba is occupied by Chinese Taipei. Mm-hmm. It is not. It is not part of China.
Oo.
Okay. So there were problems of proof. I suspect that is why Reichler did not include it in the initial complaint.
Mm-mm. Mm-mm.
Okay. Now, what is the problem with including Ito Aba?
Correct.
Okay. Among lawyers, of course, you can amend. That was the solution of Mr. Reichler, to amend the statement of claim. Mm-hmm. Or to the lawyers, it's just plainly to amend the complaint.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the rules will vary a bit among countries, but basically the rule is you should not be allowed to amend, save for very important reasons, because if you allow parties to amend, then they are not going to be accurate in making their complaint.
Yeah.
Now, the danger with amendment is you have to justify to the court why you are amending.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I asked Reichler, so
what's your justification? Yeah.
Okay. Oh. And of course the reason that you forgot about it is not a good reason.
Mm-mm.
Baka if you use the reason, I forgot about it, baka i-dismiss ang complaint mo.
Mm-mm.
We paid already for the complaint. Now, you cannot also say that baka tama si Talmon na nakalimutan namin, ay patay.
Mm-mm.
So that was the problem with amending.
Oh. But now, in hindsight, 5 years later, do you think it should have been amended, knowing what you know now?
No, you have to permit me to finish the story.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. So what happened was, I was the one who pressed Reichler to come to the Philippines because we cannot settle the issue. I consulted with the lawyers of the OSG, and then the Malacanang lawyers, basically Executive Secretary Ochoa and Secretary and then Presidential Chief Legal Counsel, now Justice Ben Taguiwa.
Mm-mm.
And we were unanimous. It's too, why are we amending? For the reasons I stated.
Mm-mm.
Okay? And then I there was an exchange of emails. We cannot resolve the issue. So I said, you better come here, because this is an important issue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and he came over. So ang mga sinasabi ni Justice Carpio that it was Secretary De Rosario who asked him to come over is not true.
Mm-hmm.
I was the one who insisted that Mr. Reichler come to Manila.
Mm-mm. Okay.
And then what happened? When he was in Manila, I called. Ako ang nagpatawag to an all hands on deck meeting. It was held at the social hall of the other building, Lacanang. So, who were in attendance? Okay. I myself was there. And for the OSG, my second in command, he's now Justice Sara of the Sandigan Bayan, and my chief of staff, Denise. Okay. For the executive secretary, now Sandigan Bayan Justice, then USEC Mike Musngi was there. Okay. For the secretary of the cabinet, Secretary
Justice Ardiles, I'm sorry to do this, but they're telling me that we're running out of time. So if we can just skip on to your final point before I ask you my last question.
Well, my point, Carminia, is that I called for the meeting. At that meeting, we argued. Now, Secretary Del Rosario came in last. And when he arrived, he said, let us not amend. It is too risky.
Mm-hmm.
You that's a direct quote. It's too risky. So the issue was resolved. The all hands on deck meeting was resolved. Do not amend to include Ito Aba. Period. Kaput.
Finito.
And then the claim now of Mr. Carpio is that Secretary Ochoa told him that the decision of the president or the decision of the group is not to include. Well, yes, it is not to include because that was the decision of the whole Philippine government.
Okay, finally, Justice Hardilesa, let me end with...
very important. Ang sinabi pa ni Justice Carpio is that pinaantay daw si Mr. Reichler.
Na hindi naman po totoo.
So I do know, nag-antay kami ni Mr. Reichler nung natapos na ang all hands on deck meeting. Now, ang nagdala kay Reichler, ako, because I wanted him sana, sabi ko kay Secretary Ochoa, boss, sabi ko, can Mr. Reichler as our counsel meet with the president? It was supposed to be a meet and greet. There was no intention that the president will meet directly with Mr. Reichler. The intention, and I arranged for the meeting, was for all hands of the Philippine government to meet with Reichler. We don't involve the president in decision making.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Like
I'm sorry, Justice Ardalesa. We've really run out of time. I still have a lot of questions here, but maybe we can schedule another interview with you. We're going to have to leave it at that. Former Associate Justice Francis Ardilesa there, former Solicitor General as well, talking to us about what really happened behind the scenes as the Philippines fought for that arbitral award in The Hague. Thank you so much, Justice.
You
take care. Keep safe.
Thank you.
All right, we're going to take a break now. Still ahead, the Milwaukee Bucks earn their first win in the NBA Finals. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC.
Laban lang.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Building in Miami, Florida collapsed. 71 of the victims have been identified. Search crews continue their grim search for remains in the building's wreckage. 31 people are still unaccounted for and are feared dead. The cause of the building's collapse remains a mystery. Motorists are in for another big-time oil price hike. Beginning tomorrow, July 13, gasoline prices will go up by 1 peso and 15 centavos per liter. Diesel will cost 60 centavos more per liter, while kerosene prices will also see an increase of 65 centavos a liter. This is the third straight week gasoline prices will go up by more than 1 peso. The price increase comes after OPEC Plus talks aimed at extending oil production cuts ended without a deal. In sports, the Milwaukee Bucks finally found a way to beat the Phoenix Suns in the NBA Finals. Playing their first finals game in front of home fans since 1974, the Bucks pounded the Phoenix Suns 120-100 in Game 3. Two-time MVP Giannis Antetokounmpo repeatedly punished Phoenix's front line, finishing with 41 points and 13 rebounds. In contrast, Suns main man Devin Booker was limited to just 10 points. Phoenix still leads the best of seven series, 2-1. And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcast. Play back this newscast to an ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it on ANC.
The overseas voter registration for the 2022 Philippine elections is still open until
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely